Fill my tethered eardrums with something to break their chains, and I will spill the entire horoscope from my bottom lip like I am water from the sparrow's hole. Drink me in so your vessels can choose from rocky rhythms that your heart reverberates through your ceramicist of a body and fall. Fall so I can show you what pity looks like while I smile and tell me one more time that no other water shall catch in my eyes besides raindrops, and I will cry oceans into your canteen and drink. Drink, instead of trying to show me how full or how empty it is, you'd never question how blue the sky is, would you? Forget the tide's reflection when you want to believe there is something for your optimism to sail over. You know, you'll never understand what it is to look into a mirror with your mirrored eyes and see nothing but infinity and still feel like it's too far away for touching. And I'd like to think that if I could leave thumbprints on the back of my skull, it would hurt at first. But when I'm something worth digging up, and I will be something worth digging up, and they sprinkle talc over my bones, roses will appear. Every time I've thought of sadness, I've thought of the color blue. Blue roses, he calls it. Blue, the color of his unspoiled circulatory system. And I've never actually seen blue roses, but I've always thought that it was because they all turned red when our bloodlines opened their hearts to whatever blew through the wind, and that martyrs made martyrs until they all insisted on being happy. Now, I'm not saying we need death for reformation, but are we going to let those dying die in vain because we don't want to be a bouquet on a mound of dirt? You know, I don't know what happened for sadness to become an antonym to blissfulness when wars are what we have waged our peace with. Tranquility is not found on the spinning needle of a compass. I saw a picture of a monk setting himself on fire, and he looked like he was meditating. Tell me that the reasons of our protests are too sad, and of course you'll be right. But let me ask you, have you ever heard about resurrection? How you've got to dig yourself out of the tomb before you can wash your hands in the sun? But that doesn't mean that you should forget what it was to be wrappings of cloth resting behind a boulder. You see, when you tell me about joy, I wonder why it is that so many people can try to forge peace by disrupting the yin-yang of tomb shadows and daylight because they want full enlightenment with no reason to deserve it. We are letting our history die in vain as we sharpen our knives of blissfulness on the broken boulder's edge. Watch us as we try to resuscitate a mummy while turning the Achman Ra into a poker chip so when it dances with pocket lint in some guy's denim, at least one man will be a little richer while a pharaoh's heart learns the beat of staying alive by the Bee Gees instead of his native tongue. You know, the one they're still learning to extract sentiment from. When I die, keep my eyelids open so my post-mortem is just what my irises can whisper from canopic jars, so then maybe you will study me. Enough to make your pride less of a beacon and more of what is buried beneath it.